Let's take a NAND gate. When there is a 0 input, the output is always 1, no matter what the other input is. It is off only when both inputs are on. Let's add one more NAND gate. Now, what if we use output of one NAND gate as input to the other? Let's try to predict the behavior using the truth tables. Rearranging the tables, we find which input combinations are related to output combinations. The outputs are never 0. When inputs are 1 and 0, the output should be 0 and 1. When inputs are 0 and 1, the output should be 1 and 0. When both inputs are 0, both outputs are 1. The anomaly occurs when both inputs are 1 and 1, which can produce both output combinations. Normally, this should not happen, but it does, and it is an exploitable feature. Let's try to confirm the behaviors first. When inputs are both 0, due to a 0 as input in both NAND gates, they turn on regardless of the other input. Then, when their outputs are connected to the inputs, they don't affect the circuit. When inputs are 1 and 0, we start with the NAND gate with 0 as input since it is bound to turn on. This output then, as input to the other NAND, turns it off due to both inputs being 1. And this output as input to the other NAND won't cause change. Therefore, we have 0 and 1 as outputs as seen in the truth table. Not only that, but since this input is 0, now R can change without affecting the NAND output. Therefore, in this case, both inputs as 1 and 1 gives 0 and 1. Similarly, we can set the inputs as 0 and 1. This sets the output to 1 and 0. Now, even if S changes, causing 1 and 1 as inputs, the output remains 1 and 0. So we can say that when both inputs are 1, the circuit memorizes and holds the previous output. Now, what if the inputs both start as 0 and then change to 1 simultaneously? This is undefined behavior. It will depend on which input change is detected first. It will detect 0, 1 or 1, 0 first, then change its output, and finally hold it when both inputs become 1. Since we cannot predict this behavior, let's call it a forbidden combination which is to be avoided. Ignoring the forbidden and hold mode, we can see the second output is always inverted version of the first output. So we simply call it not Q, which gives the negated value of the output Q. We can also add a NOT gate before the inputs, which is same as negating the inputs. Now the output and inputs have same pattern. This way we get the final truth table. This circuit is called a set reset latch. When the set is on and reset off, the data output Q is set to 1. When set is off and reset on, Q resets to 0. When both are off, this is a hold condition and the previous output does not change. The condition when both are on is forbidden and needs to be prevented. Let's proceed further. What if we add another input E and AND it with both inputs? Now, when E is on, the AND gate is transparent and circuit works normally just like the set reset latch, and its output changes depending on the input. But when E is off, both AND gate outputs are 0, so the set reset latch enters hold mode. This new circuit is called a gated set reset latch. The outputs can only change when E is high, otherwise the circuit holds its previous output. Furthermore, an AND gate followed by an inverter is actually a NAND gate, so we use NAND gates instead. Since we can enter hold mode with only the enable signal, we don't need to worry about the condition when both inputs are 0. So, ignoring the hold mode and forbidden mode, in the remaining input combination, the set and reset inputs are always different. So, what if instead of two inputs, we use a single input D and use its negated version as the other input? This is called a gated D-latch. When E is off, the internal SR-latch is in hold mode. When E is on, the SR-latch copies the D-input. We can now effectively store a data bit in the circuit. Turn E signal on, send bit in this signal, turn E off. The bit is stored and can be read as output Q. We can make the circuit synchronous, that is, make output change only at fixed times. To do that, we use clock signal as the input E. The circuit, as expected, holds data when clock signal is low. The output changes only when clock signal is high. There still remains a problem. When the clock is high, the clock is now transparent, and circuit acts as a combinational D-latch. Whenever the input changes, the output also changes at the very instant. What if the input itself depends on the current output? This is a problem because during the time clock is high, the input needs to remain constant, otherwise we have oscillations causing undefined behavior. To solve this problem, we chain another gated D-latch, whose input is the output of the first gated D-latch. We negate the clock signal, The first one receives this negated clock signal. The second one receives the clock signal negated again, which is the original signal. When the clock signal is low, the first latch is enabled and it is in set reset mode. Its output changes as the input changes, but the second latch is in hold mode since clock input is low. So even if its input is changing, its output does not change. At the moment when the clock signal rises from low to high, the clock signal in first latch goes to zero and the latch enters hold mode, holding the last detected input value. The input changes does not matter now, its output remains constant. So even if the second latch is in set reset mode, the output remains constant because its input is constant. This cycle repeats and any change of the output will occur only on the next rising edge. Now even if the input depends on output, there will be no oscillations and new input will be taken only at the next rising edge of the clock signal. This new circuit is called a rising edge trigger D flip-flop because its output is its input value at the moment clock goes from low to high. With this, hope you understand how D flip-flop works and can be made from NAND gates. We have used NOT gates as well, but they can also be replaced by NAND gates. This D flip-flop can now be used to make some of the most important components of any computers. We'll see how by completing the nand2tetris project 3, where D flip-flop is primitive part and already available. We start with the bit chip, also called 1-bit register, which is capable of loading and storing a single bit. It has two inputs, in and load, one output, out. It is implicitly clocked, so we don't worry about the clock input. When load is on, the value of in signal is stored. When load is off, even if the signal changes, its output will always be the previously stored bit. We use a D flip-flop. It is also implicitly clocked and so needs only one input and one output port. At the rising edge, it will latch to whatever is in its input. In a D flip-flop, we can store a bit simply by keeping its input constant. So one way is to feed its output back to its input. This way, we can effectively store a bit forever, but we lose the ability to change the stored bit. To also be able to load a bit, we need a way to change its input freely. For the bit chip, the load signal controls the stored value, so it will need to control the D flip-flop input. When a signal selects output, we know this is an operation of a multiplexer, so we use a multiplexer to select the input to the D flip-flop. We connect the D flip-flop output to the first input of the mux and the in signal to the second input, then load signal to the selection input. Its output goes to the D flip-flop as input. The D flip-flop output is also the bit chip's output. When load is off, the D flip-flop output is fed back to its input, simulating a bit storage. When load is on, the in signal of the bit chip is selected and D flip-flop will latch to its value on the rising edge of clock, simulating a load operation. If we had access to clock signal itself, there is an even better way using only one basic gate, which I leave you to figure out. Comment below if you can find out how. Now we have a device that can load and store a single bit. Let's test it. A 16-bit register has 16-bit input and 16-bit output and a single bit load input. The register is able to load and store the 16-bit input and outputs the stored bit. We already have a 1-bit register, the bit chip, so we use 16 of them. Then connect the corresponding inputs and outputs. They all use same load signal. We run the test. A RAM 8 chip is simply a collection of 8 registers and so can load and store 8 16-bit values and give one of the stored value as output. We will see how the 3-bit address signal can be used to select a register to output its value and if needed to be loaded with new input value depending on the load signal. First, we add 8 registers. All of them are connected to the same input signal. To load a register, all we need to do is turn only its load input on while keeping other registers' load input off. So we want to redirect a load signal to appropriate register. Whenever input is redirected to one of the different outputs, this is the operation of a demultiplexer. Here we have to redirect load signal to the load input of 8 different registers, so we can use demux 8 way. It can redirect its input to one of its 8 different output ports selected by the 3 selection bits. We connect the load signal as input. For the 3 selection bits, we can use the 3-bit address signal itself. We connect the output to 8 different internal pins first. These internal pins are then connected to the registers as the load input. Now, if the load is on, only the register selected by address signal is loaded, while others are in store mode. The address signal also selects one of the register outputs as RAM output, so we use a multiplexer. Here, we use mux 8way16, which selects among its 8 16-bit inputs using 3 selection bits. pins. We connect all 8 register outputs to 8 internal output pins and then connect the pins as input to the mux and address as selection signal. Then connect its output to the RAM output. Our RAM 8 is ready, we test it. RAM 64 is a memory of 64 registers and so we'll need 6-bit address signal at the least. To make it like RAM 8 chips, we don't have a large multiplexer and demultiplexer available, so we can use RAM 8 chips themselves to make the RAM 64. We will need 8 RAM 8 chips for a total of 64 registers. To understand how the address bits will be used, we can use a truth table. We have 64 registers, but each group of 8 registers belong to a RAM 8. Assuming the first RAM 8 is selected, the bits that select its individual registers are the 3 least significant bits. Assuming now the second RAM 8 is selected, the same 3 bits select the individual registers. This is same for all registers within RAM 8 chips. Now between the RAM 8 chips, the remaining 3 most significant bits differ. So the least significant bits select registers in a RAM and the remaining most significant bits select the RAMs. Usually this is the most common pattern found in multi-level devices. The lower level devices are selected by least significant bits while the higher level devices use the remaining most significant bits for the selection. We will see the same pattern repeat later. For now, we can start making the RAM 64 chips like RAM 8 before, but using RAM 8s instead of registers. They share same input. To select one of the internal 8 registers, they will use 3 least significant bits of the 6-bit address input. The load signal they receive are from the demultiplexer, which will now use the most significant address bits as the selection bits. One of their outputs will be selected by a multiplexer using again the most significant 3 bits of address signal. The output of the mux will be the output of the RAM 64. We can run the test now. To make RAM with 512 registers, using the same process, we use 8 RAM 64 chips, each of which needs 6 address bits, so they will use the least significant 6 bits of the 9-bit address signal. Remaining most significant 3 bits will be used by demultiplexer and multiplexer to select appropriate RAM 64 chips. Then, to make RAM 4K with 12-bit address, we can use 8 RAM 512 chips, using 9 bits for RAM addressing and remaining 3 bits for selection. To make RAM 16K with 14-bit address, we use RAM 4K, however, this time we only need 4 chips. Each chip will use 12 bits for addressing. To select among 4 chips, we only need 4-way demultiplexer and multiplexer, so we use DMUX 4-way and MUX 4-way 16, both of which needs 2 bits for selection, which will be the remaining most significant 2 bits of the address. To complete the project, we build the last chip program counter. Program counter has 16-bit input and 16-bit output. It also has 3 control signals. When reset is on, it can reset itself, that is set all bits to 0. When load is on, it can be loaded with 16-bit inputs. When ink is on, it can increment the stored value by 1. The reset signal takes priority, then load signal, then finally the increment signal. When no signal is on, the stored bits do not change. To load and store, we need a 16-bit register. Its current output will be the program counter output. We use a 16-bit incrementer to obtain the stored value incremented by 1. We can say that the control inputs are actually selecting the register inputs. A very simple way is to then use a 3 selection input multiplexer, so a MUX 8-way 16, and keep registers load signal always on. We can figure out the MUX connection by creating a truth table. If reset is 1, we set the register input to 0. If reset is off and load is on, the register input receives the input of the program counter. If reset and load is off and ink is on, the register input is the output of the incrementer. And if it is also off, the value does not change, so the input is the register output itself. This way, we obtain the order of the selection signals and the inputs. We connect the MUX input and control signal, keeping their order in mind, and connect its output as input to the register. This program counter is complete. As an alternative, we can instead chain 3 simple 16-bit MUX, which can be an exercise for you. Remember to keep the priority in mind. With this, we have completed the project 3 of nand2tetris and also hopefully understood how D-FlipFlop works and can be used to make various useful components.